I get to do issue number one. Its publish date is December 2014. Star Trek and Planet of the Apes, The Primate Directive. Writers, David and Scott Tipton. Art, Rachel Stott. Colors by Charlie Kirchhoff. Letterer, Tom B. Long. Editor, Sarah Gatos. And the Boom Studios editor is Daphna Pleben. Okay, so as we mentioned, 8 different covers. Wow. Cover A shows General Marius with a smirk of satisfaction on his face and a torn Starfleet gold tunic in his left hand. Rachel Stott did the art and Charlie Kirchhoff the colors. Cover B is another classic Juan Ortiz cover. Love his work. It shows the fallen Statue of Liberty and Kirk materializing next to the Grand Lady. The subscription covers a knockdown, drag-out fight between members of Kirk's crew and Taylor fighting against General Marius's ape soldiers and the Klingon. Art by George Perez and colors by Lan O'Grady. The sketch cover has the comic title and publisher's names at the top, and the rest is left blank white. For, ready for artists to fill in. The retailer incentive cover A is black and white version of the subscription covers Big Brawl. Art by Tone Rodriguez and colors by Charlie Kirchhoff. The retailer incentive cover B shows a huge ape in the Enterprise captain's chair with Kirk's tunic on and ripping under the strain. The ThinkGeek.com retail exclusive cover shows General Marius's head with the Starfleet swoosh, within the Starfleet badge swoosh. Art by John Midgley. The NerdBlock.com retail exclusive cover shows Kirk and Spock in defensive positions and phasers out. Unbeknownst to them, 4 dirty apes are dropping down on them from the tree limbs above. Art by Rachel Stott and colors by Charlie Kirchhoff. The scene opens on a multi-unit dwelling with a horse corral attached. A natural setting surrounds the building, and it's a windy day. Inside the building is a conversation going on between a humanoid with Caucasian hands who is handing what appears to be a Russian AK-47 assault rifle to a second person with gloved, human-looking hands. The first humanoid says, "Watch out for the kick!" since this weapon is much more powerful than the stone-throwing wooden rifles the second humanoid is used to using. The second individual turns out to be a talking ape. It's General Marius. He is impressed with the heft of the weapon, but is still mistrustful of his benefactor. The general lets go, a short burst against a wall, and he is all smiles. The shadowy individual says he only wants to help the general take over his world. Once the general crushes this world under his heel, perhaps the general will want to repay the favor, eventually. The shadowy figure says, "It will be glorious." Elsewhere, on a Klingon world, Sulu and Uhura are disguised as Klingons and making their way through a facility. Uhura uses her knowledge of the Klingon language and her "don't mess with me" attitude to get them into a sensitive area. They find and download the data they need and must fight their way out into the open where the Enterprise can beam them up. They break orbit quickly and head back to Federation space. Spock debriefs them on the stolen data, saying they found plans for a device that appears to facilitate interdimensional travel. The Klingons are apparently expanding their empire in a whole new direction. Spock says the data also includes coordinates to the planet the Klingons are using to test their new tech. They can be there in 5 hours at present speed. Kirk gives the word. When they arrive at the coordinates, they see 3 large devices, like the ones in the plans, hanging in space with a glowing ball of energy at the nexus between them all. This is the dimension-hopping device, and it's active. 2 Klingon battlecruisers, who appear to be guarding the device, notice the Enterprise's incursion and move to intercept. They fire at each other, and finally the Enterprise is able to severely damage one of the Klingon cruisers. The other cruiser actually enters the portal that appears to be a swirling creamsicle portal. But where does it lead? After much debate and orders from Admiral Komak to investigate the portal at the captain's discretion, they enter the portal. They come out the other side into what they expect to be an unfamiliar dimension. But what they find is Earth! Spock confirms it is Earth, but not their Earth. Based on planetary erosion patterns, he estimates it's the year 3978. No evidence of advanced technology or space travel, despite Earth itself being 1,700 years older than the Earth they know. There is evidence of nuclear war in its past, but rather than an advanced spacefaring race rising out of the ashes to take part in the formation of the Federation, this Earth appears to have fared far worse. Spock says there is evidence of Klingon transporter activity. He can locate precise beam-down coordinates. They enter standard orbit. Kirk, Spock, and two security men beam down in strange-looking civilian clothes that still have Starfleet colors in the form of bar-shaped fasteners on their right shoulders. Kirk uses a pair of advanced binoculars to see in the nearby building. He sees a Klingon of their acquaintance named Kor speaking to apes in clothing? They do appear to be speaking to Kor, a conversation. Kirk gives Spock the binoculars to take a look. Easier than explaining. To be continued.
That's so, pretty far in the future.
That's damn far in the future.
The first thing that I want to ask about that surprised me when I read it, and I think upon reflection and hearing the whole thing, having read the whole thing, I get it. But what surprised me was that they had to set this in an alternate universe. Because when you think about the fact that, you know, from when these shows both premiered, you could have had the same Earth that went through these different, you know, stages. As the stories progress, that becomes less possible because we know that the apes, you know, took over in the 90s, and you had the eugenics war, and the third world war for Star Trek happens, and so when did our nuclear war happen for Planet of the Apes? I get why they did it. But it surprised me. It didn't occur to me that they would have to come up with, oh, it's an alternate universe in order to make this work. Did that surprise either of you?
No. I mean, they had to do something. I mean, I think one of the first things, at least Donovan and I started talking about is, I mean, there are two mutually exclusive futures of mankind and Earth.
Right.
So how could they cohabitate? So that was my first question. How could they make them both happen at the same time? And this is a solution. It's a good solution.
I think so. I think it works.
Yeah, I would have been unhappy if they tried to shoehorn it in and say that it was the same future or further into the future than Star Trek.
Yeah, that would have created more problems, I suppose, than solutions.
Right, because kind of off topic, but Dark Horse Comics did a crossover with Terminator, Aliens, and Predator, and they tried to do that by saying that the alien future is the same future post Skynet from the Terminator movies, and to me that just didn't work. That, you know, you couldn't be in the situation where you could have the alien movies in a universe that's, you know, after the machines already took over Earth. So I kind of like the alternate universe idea instead of making it one cohesive timeline.
Hmm.
So they actually tried to say that after Skynet was defeated, mankind was able to get its act together again, rebuild, and start venturing out into space.
That's what that one comic book says, Yes.
Hmm. Yep, that sounds a little far-fetched.
Right, because they were all dead.
Yeah. Another thing I found kind of weird about this is 1,700 years into Star Trek's future. I mean, if it really was that much further than the 20th century, then would there really be anything left of the Statue of Liberty? I mean, would it? I mean, that's a long period of time. And why did they need to set it that far in the future? Did the apes have to... Was this in the continuity of the original movie where the apes had to kind of evolve into speech and that kind of stuff? Is that why it's so far in the future? Because once they start to get to the third Planet of the Apes movie, they make it, they start painting a picture where the takeover was a lot faster.
Right.
And because Cornelius and Zira, because they came back to the 20th century Earth and they had the baby, that kick-started the whole talking apes thing.
Right, but
well, that depends. That even within Planet of the Apes is can be considered an alternate timeline. So did
oh, is that what you're saying?
yeah. Well, I can show you. Even if you open up one of the DVD displays, is beautifully displayed. A Blu-ray. The Blu-ray displays this gorgeously packaged unit, and it has two timelines right on it. And it shows you where they diverge, and you can follow either one. So, you know, it's the classic causality loop paradox of if, you know, Cornelius and Zira hadn't come back, would the whole thing have started? And the impression I get is that, yes, it happened on its own, but then they came back and were a part of it, which altered things a bit.
Well, accelerated things. Instead of evolution eventually leading to talking apes, it was their return introducing the baby into 20th century Earth.
Right.
Is that
right?
That's clever. I hadn't even thought about that.
Help me remember. Does the last Planet of the Apes movie, does it end with a nuclear war?
No, it has already happened.
So it already happened.
It happens right afterwards. In fact, they go back to the city, which has been devastated by nuclear blast, and they run into characters from Conquest, who we assume later their descendants mutate into the mutants that we know in Beneath. That's
okay. Set. So we don't ever actually see the war. So the fourth movie ends.
It happens in between the fourth and the fifth movie.
Okay. And the fifth one is the one that's like narrated by the lawgiver. He's like telling some children or something.
Well, and this is where the whole timeline is you know, the two timeline theory kind of comes in into sharp focus, because at the end of a battle, which is, you know, again, immediately after, not immediately, like, you know, within 10, 20 years after Conquest, they should have the opening and closing bookmarkers with the loggers. And I think that's like 600 years hence. And it ends with humans and apes, you know, in school together, listening to the lawgiver, and they are, you know, living together in peace. And he's preaching about living in peace. So the question becomes, is this the same timeline that ends up with Taylor's Planet of the Apes, you know, in the future, 1,400 years later, or is this a new timeline? And they purposefully tease you with not really knowing, because the Caesar statue is crying, and you don't know what that means, and you've got this little girl. I don't remember if it's the ape that leans over to the human or the human to the ape and pulls on her, you know, pigtails. And so there's just this question of, have they created this new future where apes and humans live in harmony, or is this just a stage that leads us back to what we know?
Huh.
Well, it sounds like a Hollywood happy ending to me.
Yeah, I always thought that was, but Battle was never one of my favorites. Yeah. In fact, I think that the most recent film in the new series, Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, is really a remake of Battle, and a good
right.
one.
Yeah, it definitely is, and it's good.
Yeah. It's good. These new reboot movies are quite high quality. Good writing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they do such a nice job playing with an homage to the original films, but not being a slave to them. You know? I mean, Star Trek handled that by creating an alternate timeline, which now they can keep all the old stuff, and it's all involatile, and it's all there, and Spock comes over to kind of put the blessing on that, or to make it sanctioned. But but they can do whatever they want with this new timeline.
Yeah. You know, they can include what they want, or discard what they don't want. They can skip Harry Mudd completely.
Right.
Harry Mudd's a woman now.
They've already mentioned Mudd in the new series, just saying.
Well, in the new comic series.
No, the name Mudd showed up in Star Trek.
Oh, good point.
Yeah, the shuttle.
So,
was that the shuttle they used?
Yes. Right. That they confiscated during the Mudd.
Okay, incident. Then. Cyrano Jones, then.
Okay.
But I mentioned Harry Mudd just because Donovan hates Harry Mudd.
Ah.
But now she's a Bajoran female, so I don't hate her as much.
Wasn't that his daughter or something?
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, his Bajoran daughter or something like that.
I don't remember.
Anyways, that was a different story.
Yes. So in this new Apes, you know, series, they're not really even worrying about that. They're not. They're just doing their own thing. But they do have some very clever and subtle ways of, you know, paying homage to the first series, which I thought was good.
Right. In the first movie, I think I loved that they mentioned Taylor's ship disappearing.
The Icarus,
on its deep space mission.
They never
said without actually saying anything about it. Just it was in the news.
That's what I mean. Yeah, it was just sort of there. And I don't think the Icarus is ever named in the original theories, but everybody knows, everybody that's into Planet of the Apes knows it's the Icarus. And that's what they say, yeah. It took off and got lost in space.
In regards to timelines, though, do you think Spock has the right time? Because it does seem kind of convenient that he comes up with the 3978.
Like the actual year?
Date.
Yeah.
Well, he's precise. He has Spock.
Yeah, that, yeah. I noticed that too. I thought the way that he said he came to it seemed like you could give a range, but no, he gives the date.
Right, which is, I think that's the same date that's on the chronometer on Taylor's ship when he crash lands, right?
Oh my God, really? Oh, that'd be cool. I don't remember the number.
I think that does sound right to me, and certainly if there's people that wrote this have a great love for both franchises, you can tell. That seems like a detail they would check.
Cool.
Right, and but I wish they left it out because in the chronometer on the TV show Planet of the Apes, which I like to think is in the same continuity as the movies, they supposedly crash land in 3085, which is 900 years earlier than the movie is supposed to take place.
Right.
And I always kind of chalk it up to, you know, either it is truly based 900 years in the past, but they seem to reference things about that happens in the movie, so it needs to come afterwards, and I always kind of chalked it up to the chronometers aren't exact, right? It's not like the DeLorean time machine, which you knew exactly what day it was. And so it was just, you know, you could always chalk it up to it. It was the future, not necessarily exactly 3978.
Right.
I mean, what are your guys' thoughts, or did you ever try to rationalize it all?
Yeah, are you talking about within the Planet of the Apes story?
Yeah, right.
Well, the TV series, too. Is that
TV series and the movies and this now comic.
No, never, never in a million years. No, but all good points. I never thought about that.
Yes, I did think about that.
Are you making fun of me?
No, I'm making fun of me. I'm saying that that is a question that I have pondered, and I think that the answer is, of course, West Coast, East Coast. That's one thing that always comes up really clearly is that the TV show is set on the West Coast. And the movies are set on the East Coast, and Never the Twain Shall Meet, even though they have this guy named Zaius in both that looks exactly the same.
Right.
I don't know why they didn't go further into the future. It would have made a whole lot more sense. And there's a lot of little things in the TV show that don't work. Like the very first episode, the first thing you see is a dog.
Dogs, yep.
And the dogs are supposed to be all dead. So.
And the humans can talk, so...
Yeah, and the humans could, exactly. So you have to kind of write that up with the different sides of the continent thing.
Right, but the fact that Zaius makes reference to, I think at one point, the TV Zaius, he does make reference that he knows that
someone
these
came.
Astronauts are not the first visitors they've had from the past.
Yeah, yeah, that doesn't, there's not a lot of ways to around that except to say that the people that wrote that script didn't have the same love of detail that the people wrote this comic.
Chalk that up to it being a TV series, and they did what they damn well pleased in a lot of ways because they didn't think anybody paid that close attention.
I think you're right.
But I'll be honest with you. I love the TV show, and I think I actually like it better than the most of the movie sequels. I thought that it had a really good story, and it was an enjoyable, you know what, 20 episodes. I don't even know if it made it that long.
No, I don't think it was. That was one season, and they didn't all actually even get aired, I don't think. I don't know. I love the TV series, too, but I felt after a certain degree it had a certain rhythm to it that got very predictable, which is the two main characters have to run away. It was like The Fugitive, you know, from somebody else this week. Again, I'm not dissing it, but I don't hold it to the same esteem as the films. Maybe the same esteem as Battle.
I grew up when the first run of that was out. I was watching them every week. I loved them. But it was a TV show. It was fundamentally, in a lot of ways, just a different kind of critter than the movies. And I just loved them. I mean, the astronauts are actually able to fight, at least put up a fight with the gorillas, which might have been impractical and unbelievable. But as a kid, I loved at least they could do that much.
Right.
And it was just more of an adventure show. Whereas the movies, I think, well, definitely the first movie, had a lot of real meat to it, drama, a wonderful allegory. I mean, there's a lot of meat to it, where I thought the TV series was a little lighter.
I think it had to be. It had to be. Yeah. It was on 8 o'clock Friday night. I mean, it had to be.
People peeling their faces off.
Right, or being dissected, or having their brains, you know, cut into and all that. They didn't do a lot of that stuff.
Yeah.
Because I think they knew they had a lot of kids watching. I know I just remember I got into a big fight with my parents because they made me go to church youth group on Friday nights and I wanted to stay home and watch Planet of the Apes.
And that was before VCRs that you could record things.
That's right.
So, yeah, so that was a big deal. You couldn't control what you watched. You had to be there when they showed it.
Yeah. That's right.
Primitive.
All right, so real quick, back to the date thing. Just all the other times Spock has gone back in time or somewhere else in time, he's never given the exact date before, just throwing that out there. He's always said it's the late 20th century or whatever. This is like the only time I remember giving an exact date. Well, maybe Star Trek IV.
He was given exact dates, well... In general, he gives amazingly exact, precise
information. Right.
Exactly. I mean, it doesn't matter what it is. He usually does it to the decimal point. So I chalk it up to that kind of thing. Hmm. And the idea of what he's saying, based on erosion, I mean, we know from our Earth Sciences days that, sure, mountains are going to wear down at a certain rate. And if you knew enough, I guess I could see how you could calculate that kind of thing. But... I agree, not to the year, but it is Spock.
Right. I thought that was a little weak, the whole how he came up with the exact date, and it was the exact date that, you know, but Taylor was there. But anyway, it. I guess the thing about both of these books, and I think any crossover that you have that is difficult, is you've got fans of both series. Now, there's people like myself that know both franchises pretty well. But then you've got a lot of Planet of the Apes fans that really don't know Star Trek, and certainly a lot of Star Trek fans that don't know Planet of the Apes. So you have to do exposition for everybody. You have to kind of explain the other franchise. You know, you have to explain the Organians, and you have to explain all these different elements. Zira has to go through a big thing about the strata of the Society of the Apes and things that seem like we all know this. But you have to do it for a crossover because you're dealing with two different foreign audiences. Sorry, that's my thing.
Good point.
Yeah, I agree with that. Although I do think that both franchises are so awesomely popular. I think there's a lot of people that know both. But, right, there's always some people that don't know both. So
yeah, I just felt that the series was exposition heavy, but I understood why. I didn't think it was... burdensome or a bad decision, but I kept thinking like, yeah, we know this, but I could see that somebody might not because they only were in on one side.
Yeah,
right. And I could see younger, you know, people younger than me, you know, that didn't watch the original series of Star Trek and didn't watch the original Planet of the Apes and only know it from, you know, maybe Next Generation on, including, you know, the Planet of the Apes, you know, Tim Burton movie and the other remakes that would need this type of exposition.
Yeah,
even though they could think that they were fans of both franchises, but not go back as deep as, you know, we do.
Yeah, that's a very good point about new audience, younger people picking up this comic. Because certainly if they're going to watch something from Star Trek, probably ain't going to be TOS. It's like old-fashioned.
Well, it'll be the animated series, right?
It's going to be the new movies. If it's anything, but
I just realized that, I mean, it's a simple thought, but this crossover is kind of interesting because both of these franchises, which were begun at the same time, have had television shows, movies, and animated series. not in the same order.
Good point. Hmm.
Huh. And their animated series was actually made by the same company, Filmation.
Ah, that's right. That's right.
With the same level of quality.
Yeah, exactly. Put your hand in front of your face when you say that. Because then we don't have to animate your mouth moving.
Exactly.
One of the things I had about this particular issue is, other than the little teaser at the beginning with the hands, I don't think I would call those hands Caucasian, by the way. But
I would.
I would say they look African American to me, if I were going to just look at them. Wouldn't
you say? But I guess it looks very Caucasian to me. African American? You think so?
Well, or African. Yeah, I think they look like they're darker, as the Klingons usually are. But anyway.
I know, but I'm looking at the coloring of what I'm looking at, and they look like white hands. That's what was kind of throwing me a little bit, because they tend to have darker skin, the Klingons.
Huh, weird.
Yeah, whatever.
It must be a perceptual thing. But anyway, other than that little teaser thing, and one little image at the end, that was really the only apes part of this first issue. I know they're going somewhere. I know they're setting it up. But it was the same feeling I had at the end of the first Spock episode on Next Generation, when the whole episode was looking for Spock, and then he shows up in the last 5 seconds, and you're like, well, that wasn't much of a Spock episode. And you know it's coming, but I remember at the end of this thinking, well, this was very Star Trek heavy. And the whole series in general feels like Star Trek goes to Planet of the Apes more than the other way around. The ads in it are all IDW. It feels like an IDW property. Yeah, Boom is on there. But it does feel like more of Star Trek's perspective on apes, as opposed to apes' perspective on Star Trek. Does that make sense?
Yeah. I mean, despite the opening, which is 100% apes. But
right.
Yes. Well, not 100%.
Yeah. And do you think, and again, this might be a question for once we've finished the whole series, but do you think that the Klingon element was necessary to it being a good story? You know, they used that because that's how they found the portal, okay? And the Klingons were doing their usual thing of arming, you know, one side over another and all that.
Right.
But was that really germane to what they were trying to get across? So I don't know. Jury's out on that for me.
Yeah. I think it was good having the Planet of the Apes quintessential villain, the apes, and then the Star Trek quintessential villain, the Klingons. Did you have to have the Klingons? Maybe not. They could have had something else being the big problem to have to overcome. But I'm okay with it. But
yeah, it didn't take me out of it. I just was just questioning sort of dramatically what was really their role. And it works.
Well, you got to have something to unsettle the water. Something has to be a problem that has to be overcome.
Right.
And they chose the Klingons arming the apes.
Right.
The gorillas. So, just to change the subject, isn't Kirk's hair color a bit too blonde? I know this is an important point, but I mean, it's almost like Chris Pine blonde. I mean,
yeah.
I mean, Kirk was always, Kirk had lighter hair. I mean, blonde hair, but it was kind of like a dirty blonde, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And this looks really, really blonde.
And very full and rich and full. His was kind of thin. I'm just saying.
Obviously, he uses the right hair products.
Well, it's the 23rd century.
Okay, I just thought I had to get that out there.
So on a different topic as well, when Uhura and Sulu are going through the Klingon base and things like that, I didn't really care for any of those scenes, and Uhura should not be that fluent in Klingon, because as we've seen in Star Trek V, she has to read out of the Klingon English Dictionary.
Good point.
A good point, but are they, again, channeling the 2009 movie versions? Because Uhura is fluent in Klingon.
She also kind of looks, the character as drawn kind of looks like a cross between Nichelle Nichols and Zoe, I've got her name, Zoe.
Right.
Zoe Saldana, right?
Yeah, I could never say that.
Right.
But yeah, she looks...
She's too skinny. Kinda,
yeah.
Uhura, she was not fat, but she was not skinny. She was a full-figured woman in the original series.
Whereas Sulu looks very much like George Takei. And by the way, I think he looks really good as a Klingon.
Yep.
That worked. I liked those scenes, actually. I mean, I didn't think they were necessarily, you know, necessary to the story, but never is, and I thought it was good.
Well, I thought it was interesting showing the Federation doing spy stuff, because that's always what the Klingons and Romulans are doing to us.
Right.
So that doesn't happen that often.
Right.
So I thought it was different, interesting, but...
And they're definitely inside of the neutral zone, right? They've well gone past that, right? And that's never mentioned, really.
In this? Aren't they on the home planet here?
Well, I don't think they said where they were. I don't think they're on Kronos, but they could be. But I don't think they said.
Well, it says, yeah, right, it just says elsewhere. Right. But the very first shot in there looks like Kronos to me.
Sure, it does look like Kronos. And when I was doing the synopsis, I said, meanwhile on Kronos. But then I was just reading through and going, it looks like that, but you don't know for sure. I mean, it could be a colony world. I don't know.
Right.
It could be a military world installation. I don't know. So I didn't.
Good fine point.
So didn't we do a Wildstorm comic not too long ago where Spock was going to alternate universes, or they had a machine that could go to alternate universes
supposedly,
and get mirror duplicates?
Supposedly.
Didn't this story seem a lot like that with the portals and things like that? Or at least theory?
The look of the machine was different in the two comic stories, but yes, the idea is the same. But of course, we know at the end, well, let's not get too much into that story. I mean, the main point is, yes, it's very similar.
Right.
Having a machine that could have you go to different dimensions, or in the case of the other story, bring people back from the other dimensions, right? I just wanted to mention the Dana Gould essay.
Mm-hmm.
It was titled The Motorcycle Cop and the French Dude. and it's like, cool title, what the heck is he talking about? And then it turns out that Gene Roddenberry was a motorcycle cop at one point, so that's the reference there. And then the French Dude, of course, is and I'm going to... Exact period. Thank you. I was going to slaughter the name, but yes, the Pierre part I got, the Boule, I wasn't quite sure of the pronunciation. So I thought that was a really good essay. I didn't realize that Pierre Boule wrote Bridge Over the River Kwai.
That was news to me, too.
Yeah, I didn't know that. The fact they were both in World War II, both in World War II, was very interesting. And then I love the joke about the Railroad of Death, where he says that's a terrible name for a railroad. Which, of course, I mean, the reference, they named it that because of all the people that died in making it. But then he twisted it into a joke about that this would be a railroad that people would actually make a conscious decision to ride. I thought that joke was great. anyway, there was a lot of really good jokes in there. And it was informative. I thought... Dana Gould did a good job.
Yeah, I like the whole series of essays.
Yeah, and you guys know, I mean, are you familiar with Dana Gould?
No.
So, okay, well, it says a little bit about what he's done at the bottom of the essays, but he's been a stand-up comedian for decades, and he's a science fiction geek, as you read in the essays, but also he's the guy that did that stand-up little stunt where he put on a Dr. Zaius outfit.
Oh, okay.
And he had the suit of Mark Twain, Samuel Clemens. And he did a monologue that was a combination of reading Mark Twain's story about how he came to take the name Mark Twain as a pen name, but mixed in as if Dr. Zaius is doing it. And it is so funny.
Wow.
And it was like, I can see why he is doing the essays for this. He's obviously a big Planet of the Apes fan. And as we find out as you read the essays, he's a big Star Trek fan too. So.
Fun. I'm glad to know that. I had no idea.
Yeah, go on YouTube and then do a search on, you know, Planet of the Apes, Dana Gould, you know, Mark Twain. Mix it, mix some of that up, and it comes up. It's worth a
You had me do that a year or so ago. Yeah. I did not realize that was the same guy. Yeah. Interesting.
Anyway, that's all I'd say about that.